Good evening and welcome to the Bread of Life show with your host, the sensational siblings, Kana
and Justin.
This is real talk about real life with the biblical perspective. No religion, no fluff, no theology, just the unadulterated word of God in a way that makes sense and you can understand. But remember, guys, don't take our word for it. Now, on the Bread of Life show today, we're going to do something a little different, something that we really haven't done before. Today's show is People Say the Darndest Things.
Yes.
Now, we encourage you to follow us on Facebook on our Bread of Life show. Now, if you haven't noticed that we post things that are controversial. We post things that talk about what is going on in the world today, how the word of God applies to it. So you can be aware, friends, so you can wake up. So many of us are asleep. So many of us are comfortable. So we need to be shaken up. And the best way to shake people up is to post things that are controversial, that step on your toes.
Because what is going on in the world? The things that's going on are controversial.
Yes. Right?
The things that's going on that we really never seen this before, never experienced it before, from the youth, I mean, from the racial tension, from the from politics. Everything that's going on is what, Kana?
Everything that's going on today is very different. Yes. It is emotionally driven. And everyone has an opinion. And now, since we have this technology, people can freely share their opinions as much as they want, as quickly as they want, as biasedly as they want. And most people post things really just to be controversial, just to catch attention, just become popular. So it's become the popular thing to be controversial.
But what does the Bible says about all these things? What does the Word of God say?
There's the question.
In this time, how do we apply it? How do we apply something we have not heard or we do not understand? So on the Bread of Life show, we want to give you the Word of God where you're able to see it in real life terms. You'll be able to see it in today because the Bible is for the past, the present, and the future. And it is for you in today.
I believe, friends, that the Bible is more relevant,
yes,
more real than it has ever been in the history of mankind right now.
Because it is more than just stories.
Oh.
It is more absolutely than just stories. It is about your life. It is about your mind. It is about your feelings, your opinion. It's about your eternal soul. Your destination hangs on the balance of what you believe about the Word of God.
So the last couple of days on the Bread of Life page on Facebook, homosexuality, that is going to be the controversial topic until Jesus returns. I mean, it is the hot topic. And to post things about how people respond when people go out and try to preach the truth to the homosexual community.
Yeah.
I mean, here's the thing, friends. We're, as Christians, we are commanded to preach the truth. In season, out of season, to everybody. So we don't just, you're not supposed to exclude certain people based on their response to the message. The message is supposed to go out broadcast to the world. Now, this one particular video was a homosexual video that was posted on our page. And a person responded with saying,
"But let's get a little more detail.
All right.
There's a video that there's a homosexual parade going on. And a group of Christians gather together and begin to preach the gospel, begin to preach the word of God on the streets during this time. And when they were preaching the word of God, they got hostile. Some people got angry, got upset, began to say things and spit in their face. They began to want to even bend over and show the behinds. It was not a pleasant thing. But they were out there, a group of Christians was out there preaching the word of God. And when people see videos, you have the opportunity to like, comment, and share, which is a good thing. You are encouraged, please encourage to like, comment, and share. Now, in this case, we had a person, and this person wanted to make a comment. When we include, we want the comments to come. And the comment was said the same.
Well, the response was, "They will know we are Christians by our love." And the question, then they pose the question, is this love? Jesus loves all these people. Here's another question. The second question is, so how best can we calmly live or show love, display love? There's the question here.
Okay.
So the question, the in there, how do we calmly display love is the question. Well, if you notice, it was hostile. There was a hostile situation to be in. So instead of us telling you our opinions about this video, let us address it with the word of God, because that's what we do, friends. This is real talk about real life with a biblical perspective. We want to show you what the word of God says about it, because there are many opinions and thoughts and feelings, and homosexuality is an emotionally charged topic. People have very strong opinions about this. But the question posed here was, how can we calmly show love in this situation, live out love? Well, first, the question is, what's love? Because we have a very distorted view of love. So let's address the love issue. Okay. Love. 1 Corinthians. So, friends, let's go to 1 Corinthians chapter 13, and then it's usually called the love chapter.
Mm-hmm.
1 Corinthians chapter 13. Now, let's hear this. Let's start in verse. Let's read verses 4, 5, and 6. It says, love is long-suffering and is kind. Charity does not envy. Charity does not vault of puffs and is not puffed up. So it's not prideful. All right. It says it does not behave itself unseemly. Hear this, friends.
That means rude.
Yes. Love does not behave itself unruly. It does not seek her own way. It is not easily provoked. It does not think evil. It thinks no evil. But here it is. Love, friends. Love does not rejoice in iniquity, but it rejoices in the truth.
Well, I hope that we heard that very clearly. In the book, in 1 Corinthians
chapter 13,
especially verse 6, it says that love does not rejoice or is not happy in sin. We as Christians cannot rejoice or be happy or entertain in sin. But we have to rejoice in the truth and rejoice what is true. So right here it tells us that we are not to just stand by and be happy or participate in the breaking of God's law. That's the definition of sin. It's the breaking of God's law. And we cannot be happy over this or nor rejoice or participate in this.
Because there are Christians that God calls out to go to hostile places and preach the gospel of Jesus Christ, to tell sinners, to tell unbelievers the truth of God's word, whether or not they want to hear it. It's not the issue. The issue is to be obedient to God. So for us to say, how is that loving? One of the definitions of love is not to rejoice in sin.
That means that they're also to tell the truth.
Yes.
Truth is love. Truth is love. And God's law is love. And God's word is love. Rejecting God's word is rejecting God's love. So if you don't tell the truth, you're not giving love to the person to be able to see the circumstance, the situation. But also the other comment was said was that Jesus loves all these people. It is true.
That's a fact.
We must say this. It is true. Yes, Jesus loves the homosexual community. Jesus loves everybody. Absolutely. But there's a but.
But that does not mean, friends, that he is happy with your decision or your lifestyle. Right. That's what we have to understand.
Jesus is saying that he loves you, but you cannot bring your sin to heaven. He will not allow you to enter in. That's the whole situation. He loves you, the person, but he will not allow you to bring your sin into heaven. But do we know this? How can we know this without this being explained to us or declared to us or preached to us? How can we know?
There's no way for us to know unless someone tells us. How can they know without a preacher?
That's right.
How can they know without someone
to
tell
them?
Tell
the truth. But when you do tell the truth, let's say it this way. You have to tell the truth in grace, especially in a one-on-one situation. But if you preach it to a large crowd who's hostile, You don't have as much. You're not trying to be as kind. You're trying to get their attention, to provoke the conscience to say, God is saying this is wrong. You need to know it. But that is also love.
Here's another passage that too applies. Another thing we do is sometimes we look at the situation and we judge it based on what we see, not based on the total circumstance. Most people, when they see the hostility, automatically assume that it's not loving because it appears to be hostile, not understanding, friends, that we do not wrestle with people. That's not the issue.
Here's the thing. Can you love someone and they be mad at you?
Yeah.
Can you love someone and someone don't like what you say?
Yeah.
Can you love someone and they're hostile?
Yes.
But does it mean you don't tell them the truth because they're going to get mad at you?
That's not what that means.
No. If you're going down the wrong path, what better love there can be is try to do all that you can to get their attention and to say, come back the other direction.
That's exactly what we're supposed to do.
How many times have we seen parents and children are mad at their parents, but their parents still love them?
Yes.
Because that's why you correct them and tell them, because it is good for you. And God's word is love, and God's word is correction to pull us in the right direction.
Now, there's another passage that's important for us to understand. Why is this so important? Here's the thing. We have to be provoked, especially in these days, but be provoked with the truth of God's word, friend. This is so important, especially in these days. In the book of John, chapter 3, starting in verse 18. John chapter 3. We encourage you guys to follow us along and see the word for yourself, because we tell you, don't take our word for it. Don't believe it because we said it. Believe it because the Bible says it. Believe it because God says it.
That's right.
So it says, why is this so important, friends? It says in 18, it says, he that believes on him, Christ, he that believes on him is not condemned. All right? He says, but he that does not believe is condemned already. Friends, so there it is, friends. Those who don't believe are condemned.
Let's do something like this.
Okay.
I'm going to read John chapter 16 and 17, and you read John chapter 18.
Chapter 18 or
I'm
verse 18?
Verse 18.
Okay.
So I'm going to write John 3:16 and 17.
All right.
You read verse 18.
Okay.
And this is what it says.
All right.
For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten son, that whosoever believes in him should not perish, but have everlasting life. For God sent not his son into the world to condemn the world, but that the world through him might be saved.
Now, he that believes on him is not condemned, but he does not believe is condemned already. Why? Because he has not believed in the name of the only begotten Son of God. And this, my friends, hear this. This is the condemnation. Mm-hmm. Here's the judgment. The judgment is that the light is come into the world, and men loved darkness rather than light. Why? Because their deeds are evil.
You see that? So that means that people want to stay in darkness. They want to stay in what their sins and stay what they're doing because their deeds are evil and they love the darkness.
So here, when the word goes out, the word is light. Right? So when the word goes out, it's light, and it says that men love the darkness rather than the light, rather than the truth, because their deeds are evil.
And in John chapter, the first chapter of John, the Gospel of John, verse 5, it says, and the light shined in darkness, and the darkness did not comprehend it.
Or did not understand.
Could not understand it. And when you do not understand something, you get hostile, you get upset, you get mad. Why? Because the light has come and you don't understand what is going on. This is what's happening, okay?
Yes.
So when this parade was going on, here's a group of people who do not understand. They're in darkness. And how can they ever see the light if the light is not presented? We as Christians should be supporting and be happy with other Christians and go and give the light of Jesus Christ, because they already condemn until they come out.
Did you hear that?
They're already condemned.
They're already condemned.
Until they come out.
Until someone brings the light of the truth, they are going to go straight to hell.
So instead of focusing on the approach to say, you know what? But Jesus loves them. Yes, Jesus loved them so much to call them to repentance. Not to cast them away, but to say, go and sin no more. Not to throw stones at you, but to say, turn and receive the grace of God and sin no more. This is what God is saying. Now,
in verses 20 and 21, it says, for everyone that does evil, practices evil, hates the light.
Wait a minute. Say that again.
For everyone that practices evil, hates the light.
Hate is hostility.
Hate
is hostility. The light does not have to be hostile, but darkness is hostile. So when you see the hostility, it's because of the light, not because of the person. So our focus as Christians has to be rejoice in the truth that God's word is going out that saves. Because let me say this, Romans chapter 1 verse 16, for I am not ashamed of the gospel of Christ.
For it is the power of God unto salvation.
For everyone who believes, first into the Jews.
And then to the Greeks.
Gentiles. Now, yes. Is that love to go and preach the gospel? Yes. Yes. And yes. That is the love of God, because that's how God demonstrated his love, the Bible says. And we have to proclaim it.
We can't be ashamed of the truth.
That's right.
So let's read again. It says, everyone that practices evil hates the light. Neither do they come into the light for fear that their deeds should be reproved or corrected. They don't want to be corrected. That's why they're hostile. Understand? So that's why we just can't look at a situation and say, well, that's not loving. It is loving. It's the darkness responding to the light with hostility because it hates it.
I mean, because would you want someone to say, you know what? I don't want you to be mad at me, so I'm not going to tell you the truth and let you fall into the pit. You get hit by a car. You know, you get a deadly disease because no one told you and they were looking right at you. No. You prefer that person to tell you and do all that they can and trying to let you know. And if you still fall, you will at least say, someone loved me enough. Then you will say it's love. Someone did love me enough to warn me, but I would not listen. Then it would flip sides. But so, now, we also have another post.
Yes, we do.
There was another post on the Bread of Life show. And please have your post. Remember, please like, share,
and comment.
Because that's how we grow. By having a conversation, express your opinions and feelings. Because sometimes we don't know if we're right or wrong if we do not express what we think. Now, here's the other post, okay?
All right.
It was a very interesting post, a very good post, okay? And this is what it says. It said, this is what it's called. It is called The Sinner's Favorite Excuses.
Oh.
Let's say that again. The post is called
The Sinner's Favorite Excuses.
An excuse is designed to say a reason why I don't want to do that. That's what it is,
okay.
Right? Let's say it again. An excuse is a reason given of why I do not want to do that
particular thing.
So here's the list of the sinner. Now, when we say the word sinner, don't get offended, because a sinner is someone who broken God's law. According to the definition of the Bible, we all have sinned and fallen short to the glory of God. So we have only two kinds of people: sinners who have repented and sinners who make excuses.
Oh, okay? That's a good one.
So what we're showing right now, you have not turned just yet. So here's some of the excuses that we make of why we do not want to do it. Reason number one is, we say, excuse number one, only God can judge me.
Excuse number two, we're all born sinners.
Excuse number three, the Bible was written by men.
Excuse number four, I don't believe in God.
Excuse number five, God loves everyone.
Excuse number six, Jesus turned water into wine.
Excuse number seven, God made weed.
Excuse number eight, I'm a good person.
And excuse number nine, love is love, speaking of homosexuality.
And number 10 is, Jesus hung out with sinners.
Now,
the response to this was quite interesting. This is why we called the show, People Say the Darndest Things.
That's right. And here's the thing. So when we say the darndest things, sometimes the words that come out of the mouths of Christians, the thoughts and the beliefs that come out of the mouth of Christians, are the darnest things. Okay. Now, here's Christian. We will call this person Christian A.
Christian A.
Christian A.
Okay, so Christian A responded by saying, he says, it's Satan's job to accuse the sinner. This poster reeks of hypocrite and self-righteous and parasitical religion. Now, friends, that's a big word, okay? This is more of an excuse for the so-called righteous person to point out what he or she thinks is another's so-called condemnation and sins. Christ came not to say the righteous but sinners, and then he stopped. We're gonna go back and point out some things that are not quite right about what he said here,
because remember, this is real talk
about real life
with a biblical perspective.
So we want, because you need to share, we need to talk so we can see what's right and wrong, what you really believe about these things.
That's right. So the first thing we see here, that in Christian A, he said that it is Satan's job to accuse the sinner. Is that right or is that wrong?
Is that correct the word of God? Or incorrect?
Okay. So let us go to the word of God and see what it said.
All right.
In actuality, in the book of Revelation, chapter 12, verse 10, if you have your Bible, please see. Because remember, this is real talk. This is real life, what's really going on.
This just happened just last week, friends. This is how fresh this is.
With a biblical perspective. So the book of Revelation, chapter 12, verse 10. And this is what it says. We'll read the entire verse. It says, and I heard a loud voice saying in heaven, now is come salvation and strength and the kingdom of our God and the power of his Christ. For the accuser, listen closely, the devil is the accuser, of our brethren, accuser of the Christians is cast down, which accused the Christians, the devil accused the Christians before our God day and night.
Okay, so you see here, friends, Christian A said it's Satan's job to accuse the sinner. That's not correct.
Not correct.
It's Satan's job to accuse the brethren, and the brethren are those that are Christians.
That's right.
So his first response to this post is incorrect.
It's biblically incorrect. And that's the only thing we care about is what the Bible says.
Now, friends, let us clarify. We're not judging. So before, we quick to say, don't you judge me. Understand, friends, the Bible is used for reproof. Reproof means to correct.
That's right.
This is incorrect. We want to show you biblically that's not Satan's job. We're going to show you what Satan's job for the sinner is.
Okay.
So what does Satan do for the sinner? Let us go to the book of 2 Corinthians, chapter 4.
Let's go there.
Starting in verse 3. See, guys, you got to see it for yourselves.
Okay, you said 2 Corinthians, right?
2 Corinthians,
okay.
Chapter 4. Mm-hmm. Let us begin in verse 3.
Okay, let's go there.
And it says, but if our gospel be hid, it is hid to them that are lost.
Okay.
And it says, in whom the God, little g, of this world has blinded the minds of them which believe not. Those are unbelievers, friends. Those are sinners. For fear that the light of the glorious gospel of Christ, who is the image of God, should be shined unto them. For we preach not ourselves, but Christ Jesus the Lord, and ourselves your servants for Jesus' sake. It is the devil's job to blind the minds of the unbelievers so they won't receive the gospel of Jesus Christ.
There we go. He doesn't want you to hear the gospel. We've seen that the devil, he's not the accuser. He blinds the mind of the unbeliever so you will not receive the light that has come into the world, the power of the gospel, the good news of repentance and salvation through Christ who died for your sins. Doesn't want you to obey. But he accused the brethren day and night.
So you see, there's a difference.
That's right.
And how he accuses the brethren before God day and night, and he blinds the minds of the sinners they won't receive the gospel of Jesus Christ.
There's a big difference. In verse 5, it said, for we preach not ourselves. Understand, we're not preaching ourselves. We're preaching Jesus Christ. We're preaching what he said. We're preaching what he's done. We're preaching the way he said to come to heaven. That's what we're preaching. So when you hear the decisions that are made in the Bible, it's not the judgment of man, it's the judgment of God.